Of business is the Pledge of Allegiance. Please stand. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. I'd like to describe the process that we're going to be following tonight. It's no different than any other MVD annual meetings, but I think we have a few more people here than usual. You should have a registered voter card in your hand. If you do not, you'll have to come back up here and get one. Please keep that card with you. It's what you'll be using to vote for Articles 5 through 11. You also have two ballots in your hand. One for the election of officers and one for Article 4. After I'm done speaking, I will recognize the chairman to introduce the front table, and the MVD will be reading a short statement. Article 4 will then be read and discussed. After that is complete, I will open the election and you will be allowed to vote with those ballots for the officers and for Article 4. The voting booths are in back. If you have something else to mark them, you don't need to use the booth. Just mark them, and there'll be two ballot boxes back there, one for each ballot. We will then proceed through the rest of the articles. Each article will be read as printed on the warrant, and a commissioner will be recognized to move and second the article. For petition articles, any voter can move and second. When making the motion to move or second, please state your name and raise your card so that we can be recorded for the minutes. The motioner of the article will be given the first opportunity to speak to it. Following that, any voter may speak. If you do wish to speak, please approach the microphone and when recognized, hold up your card and state your name and address. If you come up multiple times, you will need to raise your card and state your name again. Form a line behind the speaker if you wish to speak. You'll be given 3 minutes to speak, and you can ask a question, make a comment, or make an amendment to an article. Comments are made only to the article being discussed. Please direct your comments and questions to me. I will recognize the appropriate person to answer the question, and we'll go forward from there. Once your time is up, you're welcome to get back in line to speak again, but give others a chance to speak. If you are making an amendment, please provide it in writing. There are pads of paper and pencil down here if you don't already have it in writing. You will need to read your amendment, and discussion of the amendment will begin. Amendments will be handled one at a time. Each article can be amended with the exception of Article 4. The language of Article 4 is dictated by the state and cannot be changed. When discussion on the amendment is completed, meaning no one else wishes to speak or the question is called, a vote will be called to see if the amendment is to be accepted. If it is accepted, discussion continues on the amended article. If it fails, discussion continues on the article as it stood before the proposed amendment. Once the article is done with discussion, a vote will be taken on the article. Votes will be taken via a show of cards. I will ask all in favor, raise your hand. All opposed, raise your hand. A simple majority is required with the exception of Article 11. If the number of cards raised for and against is close, I will ask the question again and ask you to hold your cards, and assistant moderators will be counting them and reporting back to me. Once that is done, we move on to the next article, and that process is followed. Because there is a bond being voted on, the ballot box must remain open for an hour. After that hour and after all the articles have been voted on, the ballot box will be closed and the ballots will be counted, and we will announce the winners as soon as we can. Please be polite and quiet when others are speaking. Please be respectful of others' opinions and their right to have them. Please keep your comments on the issues and not on people. Please speak only when recognized. And please put your phones on vibrate and take any calls outside of the room. With that, Chairman Woods.
Welcome.
Thanks, Bob.
I'd like to introduce the people at our head table tonight, beginning on my right, Jamie Emery of Emery and Garrett Groundwater Investigations, Mike Metcalf of Underwood Engineering, Keith Pratt of Underwood Engineering, George Chip Keller, Commissioner, Joe Comer, Commissioner, I'm Lon Woods, Commissioner, Ron Miners, Superintendent of the Merrimack Village District, Jack Balcom, Commissioner, Tony Pellegrino, Commissioner, Michelle Holton, Accounting and HR for the district, Roy Tisley of Bernstein Insurer, and Kat Joy of Bernstein Insurer.
And
if I could,
yep.
I would like to ask the personal privilege to have Mr. Miner make a brief announcement.
Thank you, Lon. The Merrimack Village District and Saint-Gobain Florence Plastics announced today that they have reached a settlement agreement to fund the labor, services, materials, and equipment required to design, install, operate, and maintain a granular activated carbon system to remove the PFOA, PFOS in wells 4 and 5 of the Merrimack, New Hampshire. Under the terms of the agreement, SG Saint-Gobain agrees to pay for the design, construction, and installation of the system, pay over the next 5 years for future operation and maintenance of the system, and to pay to reimburse the MVD for costs that it has reported in relation to the detection of PFOA in the wells. We are extremely pleased to reach this agreement with the MVD, said Tom Kingsley, CEO of Saint-Gobain Performance Plastics. We have worked hard to take their leadership position in bringing the results that are sustainable long-term for this community. With the settlement agreement now signed, we remain committed to coordinating and the needed partners to get the work done. Saint-Gobain has previously connected 18 Merrimack homes to municipal water lines and has recently agreed with New Hampshire DES to connect additional 41 homes in Merrimack to municipal water lines. While Saint-Gobain is providing the funding for physical work, the physical work will be overseen by MVD. A preliminary engineering design has been completed, and the final design is expected to be completed by the winter of 2018. Construction will begin shortly after that. We are pleased with this outcome and look forward to getting to the system online, said Ron Miner, Superintendent of the Merrimack Village District. For additional information on this agreement, please contact the office. We'll have the agreement on at the office for those who would like it. Thank you.
Okay, with that, I will be reading Article 4. Shall a Merrimack Village District vote to raise and appropriate a sum of $1,300,000 for the purpose of designing and constructing a water booster pumping station that will replace the district's existing Turkey Hill Booster Pump Station? Such sum to be raised in the issuance of serial bonds or notes not to exceed $1,300,000 under and in compliance with the provisions of the Municipal Finance Act, NHRSA 33, and to authorize the Board of Commissioners to issue and negotiate such bonds or notes and to determine the rate of interest therein and to take such other actions as may be necessary to effect the issuance, negotiation, sale, and delivery of such bonds or notes as shall be in the best interest of the Merrimack Village District. To additionally participate in the state's revolving fund, SRF RSA 40, 486:14 established for this purpose and or participate in the existing future economic stimulus funding, ARRA, and to allow the Board of Commissioners to expend such monies as become available from the federal and state governments and pass any vote relating thereto, and to authorize the Board of Commissioners to take any other actions or to pass any other vote relative to said purpose, and to raise and appropriate the sum of $30,000 for the purpose of 2018-2019 interest on said bond or serial notes. 2/3 ballot vote required. Polls must remain open for at least 1 hour. Recommended by the Board of Commissioners 400. Do I have a motion?
Mr. Moderator, I recommend the passage of Article 4 as read.
Second?
Second. Joe Comer.
Second, Joe. Any discussions on this article? You have your card? I didn't see that.
Got the blue card.
Your
Wendy
name?
Thomas.
Okay, thanks.
10 Wildcat Falls, Merrimack. I just want clarification on this proposal. It's $1.3 million to pay for a booster at Turkey Hill. From what I've read, the sole purpose of this booster is to pay or to get the water over to the establishments that are going to be built behind the old silo. What is it now? The homestead. Is that the purpose of this booster?
If I may, Mr. Moderator, I'd like Keith Pratt to answer that a little bit in terms of what the booster is and why it exists. I will tell you, it's a very integral part of our system. It's 30 plus years old. The last two or three times the board has been asked to consider funding for repairing this, it's become very apparent that it's time to put a new booster in place. Parts are not even available. They're having to be manufactured piece by piece to keep what we have going. But I would like Keith to explain to you why the booster.
But before Keith explains, I understand what you're saying, but is the time now to do this? I mean, you've known that this is old and the parts are wearing out and everything, but is the time now to do this so that you can get water over to the proposed sites on the other side of the homestead?
I can answer that again. Okay, my name is Keith Pratt. I'm with Underwood Engineers. That is not why the station is getting replaced. This station is 30 years old, as Lon spoke of. It's actually been in the CIP and has been recommended in the master plan for replacement since 2014. So it's not a new project that has come up recently. It's actually been in the planning for quite some time, and this was the year that we had targeted it. That station boosts water to the northern and western sides of town, and it has nothing to do with any of the expansion that's happening along Route 3, I think, or some of the corridors that you're talking about. It serves about 20% of York community, so without this station, those users would not, you know, benefit from the higher pressures. And the real issues and the real reasons we're replacing it, one of which Lon talked about, which is real, it's very expensive to replace, and it's actually difficult to get parts for that station. When it goes down, and it has gone down, we are really crossing our fingers to get the pieces and parts to put it back together. But there's other issues too. There's confined space issues, there's code issues with electrical systems, there's no backup power, there's no generator there, there's a portable generator that we need to bring in. So these things will be part of the improvements that will be done. So there will be the proposal is to put a new prefabricated pumping station above grade as part of this. It with a new generator and new electrical systems. So that is, in a nutshell, is what is being proposed, and hopefully that answers the question.
But would the new development benefit from this?
Which development are we?
On the other side of the homestead.
Yeah, I think this is, if that's on the Route 3 side of town, this station doesn't help Route 3 at all. This station serves the Babusick Lake area, the western and northern sides of town, so everything in that side. So it does not help anything along Route 3 or any of the development that's occurring along Route 3.
So it's simply for the west side of town?
Yeah, that's right.
And there's been an issue with the west side of town?
When the station goes down, there will be an issue. So what the district is trying to do is be proactive to replace an asset that you have and have had for 30 years. It's beyond its useful life. So what they're trying to do is do the replacements in a timely manner so that we can avoid some of these risky situations where that station goes down and we can't get the parts to replace it. So again, it was something that's been planned for the past 4 years, and this was the year that we were proposing to do it.
Okay. Thank you.
Anyone else want to speak to Article 4? If you want to speak, you can line up behind. You don't need to wait.
Kathy Stack, 7 Norwood Drive, Merrimack. I'd just like to tag on with what Wendy stated and make a comment. This booster pump, as you've stated, has been in consideration for a number of years. I hear that, and I have to question and wonder about the ability of the current board to make good decisions. This pump has been a disaster forever. It is very costly to fix it now. Yet here we are, we're voting on it today, we're trying to be proactive about it. Your words, shouldn't we have been proactive about it when it was starting to be worrisome? You know, all of a sudden, now we're being proactive about it and we're worried about it. It makes me question the judgment of the board. That's all, just a comment.
Thank you.
Ryan Stisser, 56 Middlesex Road. For clarification, is this the same booster station that a special loan from the MTBE settlement fund was announced for earlier this year or late last year?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear. Is that a special what?
There was an announcement about about MVD getting a loan through the MTBE settlement fund for a booster station in the last 6 months or so. Is this the same booster station or is this a different project?
The district did submit a pre-application to the DES state revolving loan funds for this project. They were not selected for funding through the revolving loan fund. And because of the newly founded program through the trust funds, which is an MTBE source of revenue, as you noted, this project is eligible and was funded through that program for $1.3 million. So you are correct that what you heard and what you read has been announced by the state, that this money is available to the district if they choose to go that route as a low-interest loan through the state program because we didn't get funded through the SRF. So yes, that is an option, and it's a promising program, and it's one, if this passes, that we may take advantage of.
Okay, thank you.
Anyone else? All right, at this time, you are welcome to cast your ballots for that and for the officers. I think I'm going to give a 5-minute kind of break here for people to do that instead of continuing. That's all right? Make sense? All right. Thank you. If everyone could get back to their seats, we'll continue with the meeting. I hope four was the longest one I have to read. I mean, you can walk up after some starting.
All right. Back.
All right, I'm going to continue the meeting with Article 5.
No, the name of the company is GZ.
Oh!
Article 5, to see if the Merrimack Village District will vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $3,602,322 for general municipal operations of the 2018-2019 fiscal year, with said sum to come from water-related charges. This article does not include appropriations contained in the special or individual articles addressed separately. Majority vote required, recommended by the Board of Commissioners, 400.
Move Article 5 as read.
Second.
Second.
Anyone would like to speak to Article 5? Anyone here? No? No comments on it?
No.
Okay.
For questions to the superintendent.
Okay. No one would like to speak to Article 5?
I already said that.
We'll move to a vote. This is when you use your cards. All in favor of Article 5, please raise. Thank you. All opposed? That passes. Moving on to Article 6. Shall a Merrimack Village District vote to establish a contingency fund by raising and appropriating the amount of $20,000 to meet the cost of unanticipated expenses that may arise during the fiscal year 2018-2019, with said funds to come from water fees. This fund shall not exceed 1% of the amount appropriated, exclusive of capital expenditures and amortizations of debt by such village district during the preceding year. This is in accordance with RSA 52:4-A, which requires a detailed report of all expenditures to be made in the annual report. Majority vote required, recommended by the Board of Commissioners, 400. Do I have a motion?
Make a motion to pass as written.
Second. Lon? Any discussion on Article 6?
Hi, it's Wendy Thomas again. When I was at the last meeting, I specifically asked about this warrant article, and I was told that $20,000 is appropriated every year for this account. And when I asked for a specific example of when this money was used and for what reasons this money was used, I was not given any answer. So apparently it's something they collect every year in case, but they've never used it, or they've never given me a specific example of why it's being used. So if you could give me a specific example of why this is being used, I would appreciate it.
I was the one who didn't give you a specific example at the public hearing, Wendy, and I apologize. I still can't, but perhaps Ron can give you an example.
I can't give an example. We have never used it. It's a just in case. And then if it does get used, it has to be the following year. It would be laid out, you know, exactly what we use it for within the annual report. But we have never had to use it.
You've never had to use it?
Correct.
Okay. What happens to all of the money that's been collected thus far?
Just goes into the general fund.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Tom Mahon, 31 Natticoke Road. I can remember two occasions when it was used. One to fix a pump, and another time to clean out a well that was fouled up. Been a long time. Okay, been a long time, because I've been off the budget committee since 2004, but back in the 90s, they used it twice within about 5 years, because they had well and pump problems.
If I may, I believe that the contingency fund came into being under Superintendent McSweeney. I can't remember the exact dates that he showed up. But he was the one who pointed the commission to the fact that it was available to us and that we should be using it. And I want to say probably 2004, 2005.
Okay. Well, there was some other mechanism that the Village District used in the years that I recall them using it, where they were setting money aside every year, because every year it would engender about a 30-minute discussion at the Budget Committee about what this was and why did we need it. Thank you.
Anyone else like to speak to Article 6?
Lorraine Allen, 16 French Court. I have a question about this. $20,000 coming from water fees, so that's like hydrant fees and whatever fees they are. So I'm a little confused about this, and also for the next article, but I know we're not talking about that. If we're going to put this money aside every year just in case you need it, don't you have a pretty significant capital expense, and you have a big surplus every year is what I heard in February? So why do we need to put extra money and collect more fees if we already are running pretty good in terms of fiscal? You have a pretty good bank account. I'll sit.
Okay. Anyone else? They don't need to respond. It was not a question. It was kind of a statement. So, all right. Seeing no one else. Okay. I'm sorry. I didn't hear the question.
Nope. The question was, why are we we're asking people to pay fees? Somebody's paying more fees for $20,000, and it also looks like the next article. And, you know, I'm not against fees, but we're asking people to pay fees to put extra money in there just in case we need it during the year. But it looks like you have a pretty sizable surplus every year of, I think it was $550,000 or something last year. And you have a capital reserve fund that is very, very healthy in the millions. So why are we asking people to pay fees to add in a little more money that when we have money? That's the question. Sorry if it wasn't clear.
I'm going to take one more stab at this, okay? If I may, Mr. Moderator. It is not our intention to use the contingency fund. It is there as what was brought to us as a commission as a good business practice. Yes, we have capital reserve funds. We'll be mentioning some of them later on in this warrant. And again, if I could come up with something that I thought made sense to myself, I'd offer it to you. It doesn't mean it doesn't make sense to have a contingency fund, but it is exactly what it is. It's a contingency fund for expenses that we either have not created a line in the budget for, that kind of effort. So I guess I'm not doing a very good job explaining it, but that's what it is.
Carol DePiro, 10 Cambridge Drive. And my question is, if we're not using it, how much have we put away so far?
As I said, I hazarded a guess at 2004, 2005. I'd have to go back.
No, I didn't say when. I said, how much have we put away?
It's $20,000 per warrant. Per year.
But do we know how much has been saved over these years of 20,000?
It doesn't grow that way. It goes back to the general fund. And out of that general fund comes if we have surplus, that becomes initiative to some of the other capital reserve accounts that we hold. Equipment, land use, and so on. So it doesn't accumulate from year to year.
It doesn't accumulate. Okay. I'm not understanding.
And again, if we expend a dime from that fund, you people know about it in the ensuing deliberations, at the next annual meeting. It is not some mystery. I guess it's a mystery because we haven't had to use it. I guess if a chunk of a satellite fell out of the sky and hit one of our trucks, I'm not sure. I guess, that might be an incident where we would say we'll spend a little money to tell people not to have that happen again. And I don't mean to be facetious. I just can't come up with an example.
Michael Thompson, 99 Joppa Road. I guess the question is what is actually in the fund that this money is actually going into at this point? How much money is in the reserve at this point?
Can we get him?
The contingency funds do not accumulate. They are not being added every year into a growing contingency fund account. They go back into the general fund, and some of the general funds may be through warrant articles, may be put into capital reserves for their intended purposes. But the contingency fund, if not used, goes back into general. And then if the funds are to be used for capital reserve, that would have to be
so next year they'll ask for another 20, but it doesn't add. It's not 20, 40, 60, 80. It's 20 every year, and if it's not used, it goes back into the general fund.
So if it's 20,000 every year, why isn't it just a line item on your budget?
Pardon?
Yes.
Could he repeat?
I asked, if it's 20,000 every single year and it continues to be part of it, why is it a warrant article instead of just the actual line item within your budget?
Why isn't there a $20,000 line item
budget
instead of a warrant?
Because it's not for a specific budget line item. It's for something unforeseen.
For emergencies, yes.
So that's why they've established the provision to be able to have a contingency fund.
As you know, everything needs to be in a budget. So if something comes up that's not on the budget, this is what they're going to use for it.
Thank you.
Tom Koenig, 1 Danforth Road. You can see the confusion. I mean, you moved the warrant, the article, you didn't talk about it, you didn't explain it. People are asking questions. Normally, when we've seen contingency funds or we've seen funds being established, they're ongoing funds, especially when they have a phrase that says this fund is not to exceed 1% of the amount appropriated in the prior year's budget. That implies the 20,000 adds to last year's 20,000 adds to up to some limit of 1% of last year's budget. There's nothing in this verbiage that says it goes back to the general fund, unless you're going to tell me it comes out of RSA 52:4-A that says that this fund goes back. And if you could just clearly state that, then we could all go and research 52A and we'd know. Is that the verbiage that puts this money back into the general budget?
If there are no expenditures that would bring in the use of these funds, then the appropriation would lapse at the end of the year and would go back into the general fund. And if it is used, the RSA 52-4A requires the detailed reporting of exactly what it would be used for.
Okay. That I still would recommend, since I can't change it today and I don't care to try to change it right now, that you somehow word in there that this is a non-accumulating fund and all money is referred back to the general fund at the end of the year. That would clear up a lot of people's misconceptions of what this is all about. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Barb Amaral, 1 Spruce Street. So I understand that the unused money goes back to the general fund. So we have all this money sitting there. Why can't that be used if an issue comes up? Why does there have to be this separate contingency fund that then isn't even being used? The money is there. Why do you need to ask for more money just because it's a separate fund?
We'd have to have an appropriation to be able to use the funds. So that's what we're saying, just to have this allotted for something that we don't have a specific budget line item for, or it's something that we don't haven't anticipated, but we would have those funds available. We would just have the sort of the pre-approval to use the funds if needed. If not, they just revert to the contingency, the general fund.
So then if something were to come up and you didn't have the contingency fund, you would need approval first to pull from the general fund to use that money?
Yes, we have to have appropriations for any expenditures.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Nancy Harrington, I hopefully have an answer. According to the Department of Revenue Administration, you are not allowed to have a contingency line item. Therefore, you have to have a warrant every year for the amount of contingency that you want. A contingency is separate from the capital reserve because capital reserve is for a specific item that you want to purchase. On the town side, it's an ambulance, it's a whatever. For you guys, who knows what it is. But it's designated and focused and targeted. Contingency is in case something happens. If you do not use it, that money is put into the operating fund for the next year, which means you don't have to ask for $20,000 on your budget for next year. That's my understanding.
Wolfram von Schoen, 4 Conservation Drive. Would it be possible to accumulate this annually instead of making it part of the expenditure in the following fiscal year? So we can actually have that money set aside for contingencies when we actually need it, instead of just consuming it every year?
Yeah, if it's not used, the appropriation lapses at the end of the year and it would have to be asked for again. The capital reserve funds, we do, those are allowed to accumulate for their specific intended purpose, but where this doesn't have a specific purpose, it's just a contingency, so at the end of the year it will lapse and have to be approved again.
Thank you. The capital reserve, is that for assigned, like, planned projects, or is that something that you can use for contingencies as well, of larger scale?
Pardon? Could you repeat?
The capital reserve fund, is that something that you can only use for planned projects that are in the works, that are partially approved, or maybe even approved? Or is that something you could also use for contingency situations where you need a larger amount of money than these $20,000?
Contingent, I mean, yeah. No, you have to use it for what it's specified for, period.
Right, okay. So aside from the $20,000 fiscally, in any fiscal year, you do not have any larger amount of funds available for any contingencies?
I'm sorry, I didn't understand.
Aside from the $20,000
yes.
contingency fund out of this warrant article, you do not have any additional funds available to you for unforeseen events in a fiscal year?
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
Tom Mahon, give us another shot. In order to accumulate, you'd have to establish a capital reserve fund. The DRA tightened up the regulations about the time that McSweeney came in and recommended you to do this, because there used to be a line item in your budget for contingency, period. Then they decided that wasn't fair or whatever it was, and you had that they wanted to change, so DRA changed it and said that you could put it in, but that's how you had to operate under 52-4A, okay? And there is a difference between an appropriation and a purpose. If you have a purpose in your budget, you can spend any nickel you have in your budget on that purpose, as long as you have the purpose. If you don't have a purpose in there, you can't spend the money for it. So just, you went to court about that for your garage. You didn't have a purpose in your budget for that garage, and so it was an illegal expenditure. Fortunately, the judge sided with the commissioners and said that you couldn't be removed from office because you were all volunteers and you were doing the best job you could. So, anyway, thank you.
Any other comments on Article 6? Yes.
My initial understanding, and it's still my understanding, is that the real purpose of this contingency fund authorized by RSA 524-A is to keep us out of trouble the way Tom just described it. And as I say to you, our budget is rather detailed. There's a lot of purposes. We've taken care of a lot of contingencies. I can't manufacture one for you tonight any more, Wendy, than I could at the public hearing, but I know this is an article that keeps us out of trouble for when that contingency shows up. It hasn't shown up yet, but it may. And we have to tell you, to the penny, what we would have spent the funds for at the next annual report. Thank you.
Any others? I'm going to call the question. All in favor of Article 6, please raise your cards. Thank you. All those opposed? Article passes. Article 7. Shall the Merrimack Village District vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $48,750 under provisions of RSA 35:1, sections 1 and 2, to add to the district's System Development Capital Reserve Fund for the future system expansion and improvements of the existing system? This sum comes from the fiscal year 2016-2017 surplus fund balance. These are the system development charges collected during the 2016-2017 budget year. Majority vote required. recommended by the Board of Commissioners, 400. Do we have a motion? Second?
Second.
Any discussion?
I have no further information other than the article itself.
Anyone else like to speak to this article?
Mike Malzone, 80s Chamberlain Road. I just had a quick question, guys, because this is for expansion, future expansions of the water system in the town. My question to you is, there's an awful lot of development that's going on in town now and in the next few years, and you're asking us homeowners to actually help, you know, financially help these developments go on. My question to you is, before these things are built or go before the Planning and Zoning Board, are there any type of fees that go into, you know, these big developments that are going on? Is there a hookup fee? Not just a hookup fee, but some towns have, I want to say licensing fees or whatever it may be for some of these bigger projects to hook onto our water systems to help offset the cost. So I'm wondering, like, if a development down by the homestead goes in, do they have to put up like a $10,000 bond or something like that to help go into the water system to help defray the cost of the taxpayers getting the lines out to that building? Thank you.
I can help answer that one. We help with some of the rate work too, and one of the things the district did institute, I can't remember how many years now, about six years ago or so, was a system development charge. So as these new subdivisions or commercial developments come online and wish to connect to the system, there is a charge, there is a fee, and that fee is normalized to what an equivalent bedroom is. And I can't remember the exact number. I think this is what represents the collection from last year. And those are to offset the assets that you have been paying for, for the years that the system has been built. So there are fees to connect, the physical cost of the work, the inspection services, there are bonds in place, there are escrows set up for inspection services and observation services, and there also is the system development charge, which is a significant revenue source as these new subdivisions. And I believe that's what this fee is. So to answer your question, yes, there are those fees.
Michael Thompson, 99 Joppa Road. First, thanks for clarifying the previous one. But what's the total of the capital reserve currently, and is there a goal for this capital reserve? You outlined it in Article 8, but I couldn't see it somewhere in for Article 7.
What do you say? If this article is passed, the $48,750, I believe will bring the total balance in that capital reserve account to just over $500,000. I believe that started in 2007. So it's been a pretty good money place to put the money.
And is there a goal for the capital reserve? Obviously, it fluctuates with use and stuff like that, but is there a target for the amount that is seen fit for this reserve?
There's a couple ways to look at that, and I think if you actually look at CIP that's in the annual report too, there's some recommendations there on set asides for the distribution asset renewal and the treatment plants and wells asset renewals. We do recommend, I mean, $500,000 I think is still on the lighter side of what we would recommend for infrastructure of this size. I think, and I'm not sure what we've set for goals, but I do know we are trying to accumulate a little bit more in some of the recommendations, at least, that we've made to the board.
Thank you very much.
Ryan Stisser, 56 Middlesex Road. Looking at that improvement plan that you just referenced, for it outlines $4.1 million for treatment of wells 4 and 5. Specifically for PFAS chemicals. Does the settlement that you announced today impact the recommendation on amount to be raised for the capital reserve funds in light of the fact that the largest line item listed in that capital improvement plan is for treatment of those wells?
The $4.1 million comes from the preliminary design reports that Underwood did on behalf of the district to establish what was recommended out there. The settlement funds that was announced today is less than that. And the reason for that is because some of the suggestions that are in the treatment plant work are things that are not related to the PFC issue. So what's going to happen as we go forward through the design phase is to decide if the district wants to take on some of those things that they were thinking about anyway for the treatment plant. So to deal with the PFC issue, the settlement funds covered it. But some of the things that would make sense anyway, because we were already in the process of looking at line system improvements, chemical feed improvements, considerations for generator improvements, and other things that were not PFC related. So that's why you see the two differences. So the settlement funds are covering the PFC treatment plant that's needed out there.
Okay. Would it be two separate treatment plants, or would it be one treatment
plant? It's all going to the plan is to construct one facility that houses everything that's needed, whether it's going to be incorporated in today, like the generator might be delayed just because we may put it in a little bit later. But the concept is to get the PFC treatment facility online and have the treatment facility that the district needs for the long term.
So presumably some significant portion of the largest line item in the capital improvement plan is going to be covered by the settlement that was announced today. Does that change the recommendation for the appropriations in Articles 7 and 8?
I would say no.
Okay, thank you.
Wendy Thomas. I'm still trying to figure out the relationship between MVD and the town and the state and all this kind of stuff. Just as a point of clarification, is the MVD a for-profit organization? Well, I'm the executive director of a nonprofit organization. So we go by certain rules, and we have certain rules that we have to follow for allocation of funds and everything. Is the MVD a for-profit organization?
No.
Who said no?
You said no. I said no. It's a government entity.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Any other discussions of Article 7? We'll call the vote. All in favor of Article 7? Raise. Thank you. All against? Article passes. Article 8, shall a Merrimack Village District vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $500,000 under provision of RSA 35:1, sections 1 and 2, to add to the district's equipment and facilities capital reserve fund for the associated costs with existing storage, transmission, and production of water. The sum to come from the fiscal year 2016-2017 surplus fund balance. Majority vote required, recommended by the Board of Commissioners 400. Do I have a motion? Lon? Second?
Second.
Chip? Thank you. Any discussion? Any other comments on it?
This is one of those articles that shows up every year. The district capital reserve fund, capital reserve fund for equipment facilities. Allows us to build a fund for the kinds of repairs or maintenance that becomes necessary in the large amount. I recommend it to you strongly. It's an article that shows up every year. It's much like other municipalities or whatever that attempt to keep rates, for lack of a better term, from rising or from, you know, jumping up and down on our ratepayers. And as I say, it's here every year. We recommend it to you. Thank you.
Thompson, 99 Dropper Road. As a ratepayer, my concern on this is that it actually says surplus. The rate should not be, how much actually has been taken out of surplus in the past, and if it's actually surplus, it shouldn't be actually adjusted in your rates. So really, as a ratepayer, I feel that there should not be much surplus at the end of the year. So my question would be, last year, do you actually have information on how much was actually taken out of surplus and put into this reserve fund?
The change in net position at the end of fiscal year 17 had an addition of $771,984.
So I'm actually not against this, but what I would like to say is that I'd rather see it actually in a budget as a full capital reserve based off of just putting it within the budget so that's actually known versus based off a surplus. Surplus, I think, if you're having that much surplus, it should be given back to the ratepayers or lower your actual rate versus actually going to a capital reserve. So in the future, what I would like to see is just that this actually become a clear 500,000 request versus actually talking about surplus. So, but I'm in favor of this. I just wanted to clarify rates versus surplus. Thank you.
Tom Koenig, 1 Danforth Road. Looking at this one in the last article, it looks like you've been holding $548,000 since last July or June and just sitting in the bank account, and now we're allocating it to something. Is that right? This refers to 16-17 year, which was a long time ago. Yes? So you have a bank account that's just got $548,000 in it, surplus from the previous year.
Yes, that surplus is made up of unanticipated revenues and unexpended revenues of that budget year.
But it's just been sitting in a bank account, and now, 9 months later, we're allocating it to go into a capital reserve fund?
Well, yes, because it has to come up at the annual meeting to be brought forward to be put into the capital reserve.
Well, I understand that thought. I just thought we always would appropriate whatever was going to be surplus at the end of this year into that account rather than taking whatever was surplus from last year. So it's just been sitting in an account for a while, and it just seems a little odd to me. Thank you.
Lorene Allen, 16 French Court. A question about this money. I understand why you need it, and I get that. So back to the design of the filtration, and you had said that Saint-Gobain is going to take care of it for 5 years for costs and maintenance and all that stuff. That was the overview. I don't know if there are more details in that decree or settlement order, whatever you want to call it, but what about if you have issues with them not working as they expect them to work? What if you have breakthrough chemicals, if they've had this in the Pease area, breakthrough chemicals in their second stage of their GAC filtration, they're in the process of redesigning that? What happens if we have unforeseen expenses in terms of law changes and other things that we have to do to stay in compliance with the law? Are some of those things built into that settlement offer for, you know, testing and malfunctions and things that go wrong, or would this come out of here? Is it sensible to have this money set aside for unforeseen circumstances, and does that even apply to this?
Hi, Kat Joyce. Sorry to
be awkwardly leaning over here. The settlement agreement accommodates the need for, you know, other things to happen in the future that we can't foresee right now. It carves out our ability to engage again with St. Gobain if that's appropriate, or any other party who might be responsible. So we've not given up our rights to accommodate future developments in changes in regulations or issues with the actual effectiveness of this if properly operated.
So if there's any breakthrough, which has happened elsewhere around the country, or if the system, I don't know if this is only designed for PFO and PFOS, because we have some short chain that's there and it's definitely continuing to come down the road and will increase, does the design allow for protection for that? Because GAC doesn't do the short chain, and is there room in this fund or the agreement to address that? Or have they assumed responsibility for that? I don't even know.
The agreement doesn't have anybody assuming responsibility for things that are not identified at the moment, but it allows us the ability to engage with them again. This doesn't release them from some of those things. And as mentioned earlier, if you'd like to read the agreement, you certainly are welcome to do so. That will be available for inspection during regular business hours at the district office.
So anything
And we're not going to be discussing the agreement. We're talking about the article now, not that agreement.
Right. So the capital reserve fund, if you have any other issues, though, in this topic or any other, that this should be adequate, you feel, to cover anything, because it's covered. That's why I was tying it together. I was making sure that agreement covered any unforeseen circumstances, because this is uncharted territory when we start doing this work. It's covered.
Right. Any other discussions on Article 8? I'll call the vote. All in favor? Thank you. All opposed? Article passes. Article 9. Shall a Merrimack Village District, effective May 1st, 2018, include one Merrimack Town Councilor as a member of the MVD Board of Commissioners, in addition to those elected at the MVD annual meeting, and amend the bylaws to reflect this as applicable. Majority vote required. It is a petition warrant article by Catherine Stack. Do I have a motion? Your name, please. Second. Name? Yeah. We got it. Any discussions on this? Would anyone like to speak to it?
Carol DePiro, 10 Cambridge Drive. I just want to propose an amendment to this.
Do you have that in writing?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
After talking with some legal consultation, we felt that the language needed to be changed to be allowed as by the law. So I'm proposing that we change the wording to shall the Merrimack Village District, effective April 1st, add a non-voting ex officio member to the MVD Board of Commissioners from the Merrimack Town Council, and amend bylaws to reflect this decision. This is to abide by legal counsel.
Okay. Did everyone hear that? Everyone understand that? Also, you left out 2018 on that, just so.
I'm sorry?
Just needed the year, April 1st, 2018.
Oh, I thought okay. I said it. Sorry.
Okay. So we're now discussing that amendment to this article. Would anyone else like to speak to the amendment? Yes, actually, I guess I need a second for this amendment. Second, thank you. The amended language is, shall the Merrimack Village District, effective April 1st, 2018, add a non-voting ex officio member to the MVD Board of Commissioners from the Merrimack Town Council, and amend the bylaws to reflect this decision. Discussion on the amendment.
Wendy Thomas, the reason that we came up with this warrant article is that there is a distinct divide between MVD and the town council. I've been to town council meetings, I've been to MVD meetings, and you're not shaking hands, you're doing this. Nobody is connecting. And so what we're hoping to accomplish by this warrant article is to have a member, an appointed member from the town council, sit on the board of MVD to just be a second pair of eyes or whatever, sixth pair of eyes, to just start the handshake between the town and the water. And the only reason this is going on is because we have contamination in our water. We have a health hazard in our water. And we as, and I'm talking, okay, I'll talk as myself. I am not seeing the progress that I would hope to see from the MVD in regards to cleaning water. So the intent of this article is to start a handshake between the town and the MVD. Thank you.
Thank you.
Paul McAlley, 17 Mallard Point Road. The April 1st date will not be effective for the town of Merrimack because we would have to change the charter, which is a charter amendment, which means that it will not take effect till the following April before we can put it on the ballot for the citizens of Merrimack to vote on. So the date would basically make it ineffective because we cannot get our charter changed in time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other discussion on the amendment?
Carol DePiro, 10 Cambridge Drive. Then I motion to change the date to the appropriate.
Unfortunately, we can't do it that way.
Oh,
we have
okay.
to vote on this one. It's on the table. We vote it down, and you can change the date on the next one. Same thing, change the date.
Okay.
Just any other discussion on this amendment?
Chris Christensen, 27 Great Stone Drive. I understand the intention of this article, but I don't really think it's necessary. If this is a non-voting member, if we pass the amendment, if it's a non-voting member, then there's some, anybody can go and be a non-voting member. The meetings are open to the public. If the town council wants to send or designate one of their members to go to every meeting or every other meeting or whatever, they're free to do that.
Thank you.
I respectfully disagree with that statement. Lorene Allen, 16 French Court, and this is the reason I will give, is that I believe the intent is that the ex officio member would be in the non-public session also. He or she would just be non-voting. And an example of this is, as you know, the public is there for a very short section. There are things that the public has no idea of and the town has no idea of. That's the reason, and I can give examples of that, which I won't. One being just very recently.
Thank you.
Hi, Don Preventure, 6 Wasserman Heights. My understanding of this amendment was that it was an optional thing for the town council, should they choose to send a person. I did not think that that would require a change to the charter of the town council. I don't know if anybody here can confirm that to be the case, but that's my question.
It would require a charter change. Any other discussion on the amendment? All right, I'm going to call a question. We are voting on the, come on up.
Michael Thompson, 99 Joppa Road. Do you have clarification from legal within the town that actually would need a charter change, or is that?
I have a yes from the back of the room.
Is that a lawyer from the town, or is that an individual that's actually of the town?
It's yes. Paul, would you like to?
He's not the lawyer either, right?
He's not a lawyer, but he is an employee of the town, and it has been discussed.
I question that since it, so.
Okay. It was discussed at the town council meeting a few weeks ago.
Well, I'll give you my official title.
Yep.
Assistant town manager and finance director. And we do have in our charter boards and commissions that the town council can sit on. So in order for this to change, our legal counsel at our meeting told us that we'd have to change our charter. Thank you.
Thank you. Just, you all set, Mike? Yep.
Shannon Barnes, 55 Lawrence Road. And I just wanted to take a point of clarification on what Mr. Christensen said earlier, saying that anyone from the public can come to a meeting. But unfortunately, not being an ex officio member, as this article would present itself to be, they can only speak during public comment instead of actually discuss and participate in deliberations. So when you talk about what a non-voting member of a board can do, they can still deliberate. They may not be able to have a vote. So with that, being a member of the board, you can actually participate instead of just have moments in the agenda in which the public is invited to speak as general population.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Tom Mahon. There's no official definition of an ex officio member that I'm aware of in statute. If the village district commissioners wanted to write their rules as they saw fit, they would not allow, they could not, they could write in that he was not allowed to speak or to vote. The only other time where an ex officio member can't vote is, I don't know if it's a, if you're electing officers for that group. And I also would question whether or not an ex officio member who's not an official elected for that organization would be eligible to sit in on a non-public session. Okay, I really question the legality of that. You're shaking your head no. Am I wrong or?
You are correct. An unelected official would not be allowed to sit in on a non-public session.
Thank you.
Okay, the question has been called. This is again on the amendment. Does anyone need it read again? We're good. All in favor of this amendment, raise your cards. Down. All opposed? Okay, the amendment fails. I'm going to shortchange a few things here, and if accepted, I will change this date to 2019. Do we want to continue this or not? Okay. This is the same amendment with the date changed to 2019. Do we have a motion? And second. You can't do both. All right. I believe the discussions are the same, but it's open to any further discussions. This is simply changing the date to a date that would be more tolerable for the town to get it done. Okay, no discussions. All in favor of this amendment. We are changing Article 9 to this amendment. Yep. I basically shortchanged it, Tim. It's the same coming up, and she's just changing the date. If you want, we can. Okay. Thank you. All in favor of the amendment with changing the date to 2019, raise your cards. Thank you. All opposed? The amendment fails. We are now back to the original article. Would you like me to read it again, or? Yes, okay. Shall the Merrimack Village District, effective May 1st, 2018, include one Merrimack Town Councilor as a member of the MVD Board of Commissioners, in addition to those elected at the MVD annual meeting and amend the bylaws to reflect this as applicable. Majority vote required. Any discussions on this? Seeing none, call the question. All in favor of this article? Thank you. All opposed? Article fails. On to Article 10. Shall the district require that the Merrimack Village District and its successor organization ensure, one, delivery of safe, clean, and affordable drinking water in adequate quantity to meet the needs of present and future consumers, and two, take measures for improving water quality, including a source-based solution for the presence of PFAS chemicals in our water, and three, maintain a focus on minimizing the impact of PFAS chemicals on consumer health in all challenges of water management by utilizing the body of knowledge currently available regarding water standards in other states, water system management, and contemporary water technologies. Majority vote required. It is a petition warrant article sponsored by Laurie Ann Allen. Do I have a motion? Your name? Do I have a second? Someone? Okay, thank you. Discussions on this?
It's a good thing I wore sneakers. Wendy Thomas, the intent of this article is to simply make sure that the town provides the residents with clean water. And when we talk about clean water, we talk about water that is not contaminated by chemicals from Saint-Gobain. Ron, you read earlier the agreement with Saint-Gobain, and from what I understand, they're going to hook up approximately 300 private wells, households, between Merrimack and Litchfield because the wells have been contaminated. And in this agreement, they are also going to monitor any well that is above 35 points per trillion. My well, and I'm a private well owner, even though I'm a customer of MVD, because you do cash my check, my well tests at 45 parts per trillion. I'm not included in that agreement with Saint-Gobain because I'm considered outside of the zone of contamination. Clearly, the zone of contamination needs to be expanded. Our entire town needs to be looked at. Our entire town needs to be tested. Our entire town's water needs to be filtered. The intent of this article is to simply request that you guys who sit on the board, who supply water for our town, do the right thing and clean the water up. Thank you.
Thank you.
Michael Thompson, 99 Dropper Road. I would like to commend the board here that this is really what is already in the charter. What is being stated here is actually already in the charter for the MVD. That is what they are going to try to do. That's what they've always tried to do. I feel that this warrant article, and that everybody's understands where I sit with the PFOAs and where I want them to be at, is undetectable. So I'm not here to basically say that we shouldn't get to that point. But this article, the way it's written, has no teeth. It just says minimizing. It doesn't give any points. It doesn't do anything like that. This is just a repeat of the charter of the MVD, and it is unnecessary in my view. Thank you.
Any other discussion on Article 10?
Carol DePiro, 10 Cambridge Drive. And I just want to point out that the charter I read is missing the word clean water. It talks about providing it, but it doesn't talk about being clean and free of contaminants.
Thompson, 99 Drop Road. Definition of clean is actually stated by the DES, I believe, and actually the levels that are given by the state. So I don't agree with the definition of clean by the state, but that's what the board would have to go by, and that's what they're actually obligated to try to meet. So again, I'm really want water that's fairly almost chemical free, but you know, that's not what this would actually help to facilitate. So thank you.
Wendy Thomas, if the definition of clean water is set by the state, then why did the town negotiate with Saint-Gobain to monitor wells that are at 35 points per trillion as opposed to the state limit of 70 parts per trillion? It's a question.
This is not the town, though. This is the Village District. You're asking why the town negotiated with...
Then I amend that to why did the MVD negotiate with Saint-Gobain to monitor to do ongoing monitoring of wells that are above 35 parts per trillion when the state sets the amount at 70 parts per trillion? It's still a question.
Yep.
New Hampshire DES took over the private wells. They took over all the negotiations for that. The Merrimack Village District was not involved in any negotiations regarding private wells. We were just concerned with the district wells, and that's it. I can't answer for the state why they didn't negotiate for the rest of...
So you were not involved at all in the negotiation of transferring private wells to public water? Private well households, those 300 households?
No, they took over, they were responsible for the negotiations for the private wells. We will certainly work with the state, you know, the engineering firms and everything else after the fact. We supplied them with information that was within their area that they were looking at, but other than that, we did not take part in any negotiations concerning private wells.
Okay, so my point is that the upper limit seems to be negotiable. It seems to be fluid. The state says 70 parts per trillion, and you've agreed to the negotiations with DES for 35 parts per trillion. Is that correct?
No, we did not take part with any negotiations with DES regarding private wells. We facilitated them with information of who was in this area to be served. That's it. We did not supply them any kind of information or other than that, but we were not a part of the negotiations.
Okay. Thank you.
So then, am I allowed to propose an amendment to the wording?
Yes.
Can I then propose that we change it to, as opposed to clean, under 20 parts per trillion of PFAS?
I'm trying to see where...
Yeah, I have to find it myself.
I don't see any references to that in this article.
No, it doesn't. It says...
Then you would need
delivery
to...
Safe, clean, containing less than 20 parts per trillion of PFAS chemicals.
So you would like to add that sentence?
Yes.
Could you come down here, write it down? So I need it written down so I can...
Do you have paper?
Yes, paper and pen up here. So do I have a motion to listen to this amendment, which is adding a statement in a second?
Should I read the whole thing?
Just the sentence you want to add. The suggested motion is to add the delivery of safe, clean, meaning under 20 ppt of PFAS in affordable drinking water to this article. Do I have a motion? Second? Thank you. We are now discussing this amendment to this article. Any comments on the amendment?
There's 16 French Court, research based in other states, off the top of my head without looking at notes, which I can back up if you like, just to back up that 20 parts. Michigan is looking at 5 parts per trillion. New Jersey is initiating 13 parts per trillion. Vermont, as we know, has done 20. Massachusetts is sending MCLs by the end of this summer that they say will, quote, surprise New Hampshire. I don't know what they are. New Hampshire today in committee is looking at legislation to add PFAS chemicals and further regulate them based on research. And New York, where Hoosick Falls is, has just had their recommended research based on current science, very extensive bibliography, recommending 4 to 10 parts per trillion based on researches with reproductive health, children, endocrine disruption, thyroid cancer, autoimmune, on and on and on and on. Lots of health impacts. I can discuss them at length if anyone would like a presentation at any time in the community. That's my thing. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. Thank you. Dick Barry, 12 Kyle Road. I happen to be chair of the committee in the House on Science, Technology, and Energy. We looked at the bills that came in front of us to determine whether there is any reason to go to 20 parts per trillion. I went through the documentation, all of the scientific evidence I could look at, and in no case could I find any direct correlation where it would show anything between 20 and 70 was going to give you a higher chance of any of the indications that we're talking about. The feds have an advisory level at 70 parts per trillion. The state DES took that 70 parts per trillion and said, we'll use that. That's the best scientific evidence that we have at this time. They will have people testing water and doing more, but let's leave it up to the experts. The folks up at the state level know what they're doing, understand this, have our best interests at heart. Please turn this thing down. Thank you.
Good evening. Kristen Ayers, 19 Jakes Lane. Here's my card. I just want to point out, thank you, Representative, that not too long ago, those very same specialists that you were talking about, the experts, also indicated that 400 parts per trillion was the safe level. That was changed to 100 parts per trillion when this crisis broke, and then it was changed to 70 parts per trillion. So keep that in mind, please.
Allen, I want to state for the record that I'm really, really disappointed and upset with our representatives and the state of New Hampshire for disrespecting research. I will tell you names. Philip Grandjean, Harvard University. Dr. Alan Duchtman, look him up. He is the C8 study guru in this topic. We conference called with him 2 weeks ago. Gloria Post of the New Jersey Quality Water Institute, Judith Enck, the ex-director of the EPA. I can go on and on and on. I'm upset about this. The research is there, and I'm very, very tired of people hiding. It's not your fault. You're not in research. I'm sorry. Your water management. But I do want to say for the record that this disregard and looking at the EPA guidance, which is very, very much business friendly, is wrong. It's absolutely wrong, and there is research. And I have a Google Drive full of it, and if anybody in this town wants to see it, it's there. And these names are undisputed. They are respected. The New Jersey Quality Water Institute is the most respected in the country. Their research is solid, peer-reviewed science. This is not fake news. This is not fake science. I've been here since 85. I don't want this in my town. I see a lot of people who are really, really impacted by this. And to say we don't really know what causes it, I'm not going to tell you it is definitively this, but I'm going to tell you that the research in health is clear on this topic. And any representative of this town with the illness that we have in this town and children and stories that they've heard from people that they ignore, they do not respond to in these committees is appalling. To disregard that science and blindly follow and cite the EPA, which they've stated in stormwater drain is 10 years behind. So when it suits them, the EPA is way behind, and we know what's best for New Hampshire, but in this case, they follow it. The science is clear on this topic.
Wendy Thomas, I'm shocked to hear any of our elected officials speak the way that Representative Barry just spoke. The state of New Hampshire, the state of Vermont, lowered their PFOA standards because of results on children. That's where they got the evidence to lower it. It's been proven that lower body weight, if you have a lower body weight, PFOAs affect you more significantly than if you have a larger body weight. Veterinarians around the area have noticed a cancer cluster of pets, cats and dogs in Merrimack, who obviously drink the water. To say that there is no scientific evidence that PFOAs affect you disregards the research that Vermont did. It disregards the research that New York State did. It disregards the research that Minnesota did. It disregards the research that New Jersey did. It's ludicrous, it's insultive, and that's it, I'm done.
It's not gonna be registered.
Sharon Varney, 76 London Court. I'd like to call the question, please.
Thank you. This is on the amendment. We are basically replacing line one to read the delivery of safe, clean, meaning under 20 ppt of PFAS and affordable drinking water, continues in adequate quantity to meet the needs, and so on. So this is replacing line one, the first section of it. Everyone understand? Thank you. All in favor? Thank you. All opposed? Fails. We are back to the original article. Any other discussions on the original article as written? I'll call the question. All in favor of Article 10? Thank you. All opposed? Article fails. Article 11. Shall a district, effective immediately, require that the Merrimack Village District, MVD, cooperatively engage in a transition plan with the Town of Merrimack government, Town Council, Town Manager, and their assignees to meet all legal and ethical requirements required to both 1. Disband the municipal entity, the MVD, and the Board of Commissioners currently managing the Merrimack, New Hampshire water system. And 2. Transfer complete oversight and management of the Merrimack, New Hampshire water municipality to the Town of Merrimack, New Hampshire. The dissolution of the MVD and transfer of responsibilities for and management of the Merrimack, New Hampshire water municipality is to occur on or before April 15th, 2019, specific date to be determined by the Town of Merrimack. The transition plan will include immediate and unrestricted access for the Town of Merrimack government, Town Council, Town Manager, and their assignees to any and all MVD sites, facilities, records, activities, and oversight of all Merrimack Water Systems related matters / MVD affairs. The expectation is one of complete and thorough transparency into all business matters, inclusive of those deemed non-public, private, confidential, and or other terms used to refer to protected information. This immediate transparency and oversight is to include full disclosure of records and specifics of any and all legal matters MVD has engaged in prior, at present, or anticipated, and for the Town of Merrimack on behalf of its residents to become a party to any legal proceedings related to Merrimack, New Hampshire water, which they deem appropriate. 2/3 vote required. Petition article sponsored by Nancy Murphy. Do I have a motion? Do I have a second? See a second. Any discussion on this article?
Wendy Thomas, I motion that the language of Article 11 be amended to incorporate the legalities that were not prior known and clarify without changing the article's intent to give the town the authority to review and after a review to put before the voters whether it is in the best interest of residents to create a town water department. Do you want me to read the new one?
You can read it and then hand it to me. I'll need it. You have a second copy?
Okay, so the amended article.
This is to replace the entire article, correct?
Correct.
Thank you.
Shall the district, effective immediately, require that the Merrimack Village District engage with the Town of Merrimack government to meet all legal requirements required to disband the municipal entity, the MVD, and the Board of Commissioners currently managing the Merrimack, New Hampshire water system for the purpose of creating a town of Merrimack self-funded water department. The dissolution of the MVD and transfer of its responsibilities and management to the Town of Merrimack, New Hampshire, is contingent on the Merrimack town government agreeing to accept such responsibility and after opportunity to complete a comprehensive review process, a decision to move forward in acquiring ownership of MVD assets. If the Town of Merrimack chooses to proceed, details and disclosure of financial impact will be made to the Merrimack voters and a special election will be held to acquire ownership of the MVD assets. If the town government declines to proceed with the establishment of a self-funded Merrimack Water Department or voters do not approve such an establishment, the MVD will continue to be the municipal entity of the Merrimack, New Hampshire water system. This process will be completed by April 2020 with a timeline to be determined by the Town of Merrimack. In order to make a current analysis of functioning, the Town of Merrimack government and its consultants shall be granted access to all MVD sites, facilities, records, activities, and business pertaining to all Merrimack water system related matters and MVD commissioner affairs. The expectation is one of full disclosure into all business matters, inclusive of those deemed non-public, private, or confidential protected information, and includes the records and specifics of any and all legal matters MVD has engaged in, is presently engaged in, or is anticipated to be engaged in. Thank you.
Thank you. Do I have a motion? Second? Discussion on the amendment as read.
Nancy Murphy, 20 Brenda Lane. In the interest of time, I prepared a statement regarding this warrant article. As a Merrimack resident for 34 years, who's had the opportunity to observe how public servants have served us in town government, the MVD, and various boards, I'd like to start off by saying thank you to every person who currently or has in the past volunteered to serve all of us. I recognize that despite the many benefits of public service, it can also be a thankless job and one fraught with adversity and challenge. Despite this, individuals continue to step up to do what they believe is right, and most often do so for the right reasons. Sometimes, residents, on behalf of community members, do so as well. Today, I find myself in that position. I'm here tonight to address Warrant Article 11 as originally submitted and as amended. As we all know, Merrimack's water is contaminated. In addition to the daily functioning of any water system management entity, the MVD has been challenged to deal with this. As such, more attention has been paid to the MVD, how it functions, how it's managed, and how it's responded to this problem. Recognizing the seriousness of this contamination issue, that we didn't cause it and that it must be fixed, residents have become more informed, are speaking out, and are asking questions. They're making their voices heard and expectations for advocacy known, both to town government and the MVD. They're looking for the best way to meet their water needs and how to make that happen. Article 11 was proposed based upon feedback from MVD customers who shared concerns about the quality of Merrimack water, the potential impacts of PFAS chemicals upon themselves and their families, the transparency and accountability of the MVDA and of the MVD, and experiences with and knowledge of MVD business and management practices. It was not created to disparage the MVD, but rather in recognition of all those concerns, of the unfortunate place we currently find ourselves in as regards our water and the burden placed on the MVD, and to explore an option for an alternative water system management entity that might better meet the needs of the town. The article was submitted on February 16th with more than required number of MVD customer signatures of support. It is an attempt to provide MD customers an alternative and self-funded water system management option by an entity that values Merrimack as much as we do. The town of Merrimack meets that criterion.
Thank you. Mike?
Mike Malzone, 80s Chamberlain Road. I'd like to speak to Article 11. I understand.
You're speaking to the amendment, correct?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
I understand the meaning behind this, and I appreciate what the ladies are trying to do, but I also appreciate what the board's trying to do. I've been living here in town for 30 years. I haven't really had a problem with the water, but I think I would have a problem with the town council and the town taking over the water system in the town. I'm not prepared to be paying $200 a month for my water bill. It would be cheaper for me to be buying water. The last thing I want to see would be seeing, I feel, if the town took it over, would be 5 to 7 new water trucks driving around town with more employees. I prefer the way status quo, do a little better with your job that you guys are doing. You're pretty fiscal with the way that you're spending money. The water quality is there in my neighborhood. If it isn't in others, I'm sure that if it's addressed, you people do the best to fix that. But the last thing I want to see is the town take over the water in this town. My property taxes have gone up $2,000 in just the last 8 years in this town. I can only imagine what will happen to my water bills if the town gets a hold of it. Thank you.
Chuck Mower, 4 Depot Street. I'm so glad I came this evening. 50 years ago this week, I landed in the Republic of Vietnam, tiny village up in the I Corps, about halfway between Da Nang and Chu Lai, and that's where I spent the next year. My government lied to me. They lied to me about why I was there. They lied to me about what I was doing. And they lied about a chemical called Agent Orange. Well, I'm sure they were well-intended. I'm sure they had the best science. I'm sure of all those things. But over time, it came to pass that the truth was different, that my government lied to me, and that I had been poisoned. It's difficult to be poisoned. It's difficult to believe that your government can poison you. And how did all this happen in Vietnam? Well, it turns out in retrospect, all these years later, that the problem was that the problem could not know itself. As Albert Einstein said, you cannot solve a problem by using the same thinking that created it. The next time I was knowingly poisoned by my government was my local government, which is supposed to be the government that's closest to you and open for your participation. God knows I've tried to participate in my local government. I was poisoned by the Merrimack Village District when well number 6 was contaminated with some of the most insidious chemicals. Whatever happened to well number 6? Well, the people came to a meeting and they shut it down and said, do something about it. All these years later, we still don't have any real accounting for well number 6 or the damages that we suffered. I could point to any number of other faux pas that have conflicted the town of Merrimack's operation and the operation of the Merrimack Village District. They're well known. They're well understood.
Wrap it up, Chuck. 3 minutes.
Excuse me?
3 minutes is up.
I'm going to have a point of privilege. I think I'm a native. I've been around long enough. There's not much more to go. I think you could give me a little liberty on that, don't you?
It's up to the body. Thank you. You're good.
It is not a secret in this community about the great conflict that exists between the Village District and the town of Merrimack. And why do you suppose there is that conflict? Why? Why is there not more harmony? What is the enmity between the Village District and the town of Merrimack, where one is always stepping on the other, but the other isn't always stepping on the one? I think you people are at the top of your game this evening. I haven't witnessed anything that I haven't been confirmed about in the last 20 years in the operation of the Merrimack Village District. Why you can't even admit that you have poisoned the people of the town of Merrimack? You are culpable in this. You are not victims. You are participants, culpably, in covering up and deceiving and dissembling and obfuscating, all of these things. This is what has led to the enmity. People do not know where to go to get representation on the issues that affect their bodies and their soul when it comes to the water that we consume. Have you no thought whatsoever to apologize for any of this to the people that have been affected? I have been poisoned. I know the subtleties that it does to my system. There are people that have been poisoned by your water that make the same claims that you so easily want to dismiss or just not even care about. I am a firm believer that when government does something, it does it in all of our names. And that is why I'm standing here this evening, because I cannot, in good conscience, allow myself to participate in my good name of government poisoning anybody. I just cannot. The Merrimack Village District form of government is dead. And you have demonstrated clearly why it is dead. It is not functioning. And it is not going to function no matter what you do. Board after board after board has confirmed that systemic failure of the village district to represent the best interests of the town of Merrimack. The only question that's left is when are we going to have the funeral and how much is it going to cost?
Sharon Barney, 76 London Court. Moderator, I'd like to call the question, please.
Is there anyone else that would like to speak to this?
Yeah, Wendy Thomas, I just want to add.
Yes, it was. I'm continuing discussion. There's one more person, then we'll call the question.
As you know, I'm a private well owner. Although I do drink water from the town, my kids drink water in the school system. We've lived in our house for 25 years. Recently, we purchased a whole house filtration system at a price of $1,100. With it comes a reverse osmosis system that is going to be on a POU, which is a point of use, which is going to be our kitchen faucet. That will be the only faucet that our family will be able to drink from. Between the two systems that we have in our household, we have a guarantee that our water will be clear of all contaminants. Our household will be drinking clear water. I keep coming up here tonight, and I know you guys are sick of me, and that's too bad. I keep coming up tonight because we are fortunate enough to afford a system like that. There are so many people in town that cannot afford whole house filtration systems. They cannot afford to buy bottled water. And right now, we're buying about 25 gallons of water a week just for our household to not drink our. So the reason I'm up here is because it's our town. It's our town. It's not just our household. It's our town that is contaminated. We need help. Whether that help comes from the state or whether it comes from the town, the town needs help, and that's why I keep coming up.
Thank you. And I'll be calling the question on the amendment to Article 11. We are voting to change the wording to what was read. Do we need it read again? Thank you. This is to change the wording to 11. It is not voting on 11, it's changing the wording to the amendment. All in favor? Thank you. All opposed? The amendment fails. We are back to the original amendment. Is there any further discussion on Article 11 as it is printed? Seeing none. This article needs a two-thirds majority. I am going to call a question, get a number, and if it's nowhere near, I'm going to call it. If it's close, we're going to have to count, which isn't a problem, but I just want you to know what's going to happen. Okay? So, all in favor of Article 11 as printed. Thank you. All opposed? The article fails. At this point, I'm closing the ballot boxes and we will begin counting and tabulating those ballots. Thank you.
District. Reconsideration on all previous articles.
There is a second. There is a motion to restrict all reconsideration of articles voted on. All in favor? Thank you. All opposed? Reconsideration motion passes. What? Yes. If we could have your attention, please. There's a presentation that the MVD would like to do right now.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is a moment that I thought I wouldn't have to do, but I'm doing it anyways. Ron, Lon Woods won't be commissioner for much longer. And we're going to miss him. I'm going to miss him because he did most of the work. I just nodded my head. So at this time, I'd like to present Ron. Can you come up, Ron? Come on up. I want to present Ron with this plaque from the Merrimack Village District for all the years that he served and all the time that he covered me because I needed to be covered. So, Ron, I'm sorry to see you go. I wish you could stay longer, but I understand what's going on. So here you are, to Lon Woods. In appreciation of 20 years of service in the Merrimack Village District as Commissioner and Chairman in the Board of Commissioners, I appreciate you. Thank you very much.
Given some of the remarks earlier tonight, it's somewhat humbling. I can't let Tony go without letting everyone here know that I have appreciated him too. The last MVD election I lost to him by one vote. I made sure on the way back that he was still with us. Thank you, Tony. Thank you. Thank you. And thank you.
And I thank Ron for all the years he's been serving with me. And I'm kind of disappointed I beat him by one vote. But what can you do? Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Test.
Oh, yeah.
Chris, nothing, Chris? Chris. Bouncing.
Oh, I can't wait to find the truck, though. Can't wait to find the truck.
Test, 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Yeah. Thank you.
that one. There's that one under there.
Okay.
And is there another one? That one under the
No, because it's the date one and then the 20.
Right, the date one. Yeah, it's a little slip of paper. I know where it is. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'd like to announce the results of the Article 4 Turkey Hill Booster, 173 for, 42 against. The article passes 80-20. For the officers, Jack Balcom, 95, Don Preventure, 168, Wolfram Von Skull, 119. Treasurer, Lynn Christensen, 89, Catherine Stack, 113. Moderator, Brian McCarthy, 165. There were two write-ins. That's it. Thank you. I will entertain a motion.
Motion adjourned. Seconded.
Thank you. Meeting is adjourned.